Fundamental Excellence was established in an effort to recognize personnel, both military and civilian, who have made significant contributions as multifunctional logisticians. General Sommerville's accomplishments as the Army's chief logistician during World War II were marked by consistent ability to get things done. In late 1941, he completed the building of the Pentagon inside of 18 months. And in March 1942, General George C. Marshall, Army Chief of Staff, named General Sommerville Chief of the Army Services of Supply. The certificate reads, "To all who shall see these presents, greetings. Be it known that Clark W. LeMasters, Jr., having distinguished himself as a multifunctional logistician, is therefore awarded the General Greenhorn B. Sommerville Medal of Excellence, signed James L. Hodge, Major General, U.S. Army, Commanding." At this time, we ask that Brigadier General LeMasters' wife, Cricket, please join her husband. Major General Hodge will now present Mrs. LeMasters with a certificate of appreciation. For exceptional support during her husband's tenure as a commandant at United States Army Ordnance School, Fort Lee, Virginia, she has earned our grateful appreciation and admiration for the personal sacrifices made throughout this assignment. Mrs. LeMasters' patronage to improve morale and family readiness demonstrated her overall allegiance to Brigadier General LeMasters, the soldiers and civilians of the Ordnance School. Without a doubt, her unwavering commitment was instrumental in allowing him to focus his efforts on training our young soldiers. The devotion of Mrs. LeMasters serves as an example for all to emulate and reflects great credit upon her, the United States Army Combined Arms Support Command, and the United States Army. Brigadier General LeMasters will now present his wife with the Ordnance Order of Samuel Sharp Award. In May of 1994, U.S. Ordnance Corps Association initiated a program to ensure that ordnance personnel receive recognition for their deeds that go above and beyond the norm. In order to recognize and honor the best of the best in our Corps, the association created the Ordnance Order of Samuel Sharp. The medal depicts an eagle holding a flintlock rifle surrounded by oak leaves with a shell and flame overhead. The eagle represents America's freedom, which has been defended faithfully and to its fullest measure by members of the Corps since 1812. The flintlock rifle represents our Corps' beginnings, as well as the material support provided by Ordnance personnel in both peace and war. The oak leaves represent the strength and resolve of the Ordnance Corps to stand the test of time. The shell and flame represents the unleashed energy of the Ordnance Corps. To all Ordnance personnel, wherever ye may be, be it known that Colonel Cricket LeMasters, having been tried and found worthy to be numbered as one of our trusty members, has been gathered to our fold and duly initiated to the solemn mysteries of the traditional brotherhood of gunsmiths, wheelwrights, and metalworkers. Issued this 20th day of March, 2012, signed Brigadier General Clark W. LeMasters, Jr., Chief of Ordnance. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, please hold your applause until all individual presentations are complete. Please welcome Brigadier General Bingham from the United States Army Quartermaster School, who will present Brigadier General LeMasters with a gift.
Good morning, everyone. imply the state privilege to add to what has already been done with my battle buddy, Clark LeMasters, who is also my neighbor. Clark, you have been a wonderful teammate, comrade, friend, and logistician, sustainer. We're going to miss you here. PJ is out of town, otherwise he'll join me here for this occasion. We have a couple bags that we have, if you can open up the computer, the tall one, though I want you to open up here shortly. Not yet. You can open that little one at your leisure. What's in the little bag is some memorabilia from the Quartermaster Corps. I think there's a polo shirt to remind you all the Quartermaster men and women that will be in your formation once you get out there to the 13th ESC. And I know you're going to appreciate them as you appreciate all of your soldiers that will be under your charge. Clark's on his way to Fort Hood, Texas. I lived in Texas as a kid for about 13 years growing up. And I spent another 6 years inside the Fort Hood, so I wanted to give you something that would be special about the place that you're getting ready to go to. And they say that everything in Texas grows big. So open up that silver bag and you can put in your favorite, whatever you want.
Yeah!
None of that's work. Yeah, you gotta fill it up, my friend. That's right. But on a serious note, you know, the 46th Quartermaster General once told me, and I've said this a lot, but it's very special in the case of Clark and Cricket and his family. Nobody cares how much you know until they know how much you care. Late October, my husband had hip surgery, and Clark and Cricket went into a deep action. They brought over a chase lounge for PJ to recuperate in. Cricket made him a big old apple pie. He's still talking about that Cricket. But we just want to say, and Clark cooked us a barbecue. I just want to publicly acknowledge to you that I really appreciate your caring for my hubby, and thanks for all you do. We want to induct you as an honorary member into the Ancient Order of St. Martin, and at this time we'll publish that order.
St. Martin, the patron saint of the Quartermaster Regiment, was the most popular saint in France during the antiquity and early Middle Ages. It is said that French kings carried his cloak into battle. Be honored by this individual's presence that Brigadier General Clark LeMasters Jr., having been tried and found worthy to be numbered as one of our trusty members, has been gathered to our fold and duly initiated into the solemn mystery of this esteemed.
Please welcome Mr. Hall from the Army Logistics University, who will present Brigadier General LeMasters with a gift.
Well, good morning, everyone, and thanks for being here today. And I'd like to thank Clark for what I did for my remarks. Clark, I would like to say, please, before you get on that plane to Afghanistan, I'd like to respect the content. General Brigham escaped. General LeMasters is, and I'm the old commandant this way, one of the customers. And he's been a great partner, and I hope that we produce the products that you're seeking with these great witnesses that you send over to the logistics university. But I can't think of a better partner than we've had here to help AOU continue to stand up and assume our role in training and education. Just as leaders around the body. So, Clark, thanks. And I wish you nothing but the best in the sign triple that is. And I'd like to also thank Cricket. Most of you probably don't know this, but Cricket was my XO for the year. And we had some adventures together, I'll tell you that. But I can't imagine being able to do the job that I did with Cricket's assistant. So, Cricket, I probably never properly thank you for that, but you're so now for the support that you've made for all the support students and faculty of family. Thank you. So let me move over.
I'd like to got a nice ALU polo shirt, by the way.
over to you. ALU beer beer.
Please welcome Colonel Promotable Farman from the United States Army Transportation School, who will present Brigadier General LeMasters with a gift.
Well, it's great to be here, and picking up on the theme, of course, of teamwork. I mean, without a doubt, between all us commandants, there's nothing that, it's all about partnership and teamwork. And I've been following Clark around a little bit, or General LeMasters around a little bit, because I replaced him in the job before I came to this one as the XO in the Army G4, and then migrated to Fort Lee. As such, and I've gotten a lot of great transitional support and a lot of great tutelage from General LeMasters, primarily over cigars, which we had a tendency to take part in that even when I was transitioning up in D.C., and then, and more importantly, when I got here to Fort Lee, we used to have a lot of good sessions, not only out back at his house, but even when we were traveling to TDY, and that's when we had the opportunity to I got kind of inducted into how things took place here at Fort Lee. And I'm very appreciative for that, actually, General LeMasters. And so with that, we have some guests, just like the quartermaster. Most importantly, I wanted to have that cigars handed to you because we line that with, on there it says the 70th, birthday of the Transportation Corps on the liner of that cigar. So next time we share it, or you share it in Afghanistan, when you get over there and you have it, just think of the Transportation Corps and the smoke out. And of course, in the rest of the bag is more trinkets for you to remember the Transportation Corps. It's a distribution fight when you get over there, and certainly we want to make sure you keep the Transportation Corps near and dear to your heart. Where you find the senior transporter to hand that off to, I don't know how you're gonna work that when you get there. But again, Cricket, we're not going to present her with anything today because she's not leaving. She's going to be our neighbor for another 2.5 months or maybe longer, and we'll look forward to an appropriate time to say goodbye to you, Cricket, and we're just happy you're going to stay our neighbor for a little bit longer, and we appreciate both of you and everything you've meant to us as teammates and neighbors. And with that, we're also going to present the St. Christopher Award, the Honorable Order of St. Christopher to General Master. So, Captain Corcoran, if you could publish the orders, please.
Yes, sir. St. Christopher, patron saint of the Transportation Corps of Britain, one of the most popular saints during antiquity and the early Middle Ages. Usually pictured carrying Christ as symbolically the way of the world's sins across the river, the image of the St. Christopher offers a fitting symbol of strength, loyalty, and safety for transporters, cars, moving the force, now and for all time. To all transporters, wherever ye may be, greetings. Know ye that there appeared before the most arduous and selected committee of proven transporters, elected candidate for the Honorable Order of St. Christopher. Do you remember that the hereinafter mentioned individual has been inspected and passed over by ourselves and our loyal staff, and be it known by all you transporters may be honored by this individual's presence that Brigadier General Clark LeMasters Jr. has been tried and found worthy to be numbered as one of our trusty members, has been guided into our fold and duly initiated into the solemn mysteries of this esteemed order of transport. Be it understood that we hereby confer upon this individual the shield of St. Christopher and enjoin all transporters to show due honor and respect whenever this individual may enter their midst. Given under my hand this 21st day of March 2012, signed Stephen E. Farman, Colonel Promotable, Chief of Transportation.
Please
metal bottom like that.
At this time, we will now conduct the relinquishment of command ceremony. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to direct your attention to the center where Major General Hodge, Brigadier General LeMasters, and Command Sergeant Major Muhammad will now transfer the ordnance school colors. The foundation of a military unit is symbolized in its colors, for they record the glories of the past, stand guardian over its present destiny, and provide inspiration for its future. Traditionally, in the military, the passing of the unit colors has been used to symbolize the changing of command. We are going to witness the passing of the ordnance organizational colors from the outgoing commander to the CASPCOM commander, thereby relinquishing his command. Colonel Mason, the Chief of Staff, will assume duties of the Acting Commandant until Brigadier General LeMasters' replacement is announced. Ladies and gentlemen, Major General James L. Hodge.
Good morning, everyone.
You know, this week marked the first day of spring. And spring is a time of renewal, new beginnings, really endless possibilities. And on this beautiful spring day, here at the Home Sustainment, you just witnessed a relinquishment of command ceremony where we've marked the departure of Brigadier General Clark LeMasters, 36th Chief of Ordnance and the Commandant of the U.S. Armed Forces. I would like to extend a special welcome to General LeMasters' wife, Cricket. I'd also like to extend a warm welcome to General Retired Johnny Wilson, a former AMC commander and a former DAG. Thank you, sir. Lieutenant General Retired Dave Wiseman, he is our civilian aide, Secretary of the Army, and I think all of us here know just how much he does with the in that role. We also have with us Mayor Christina Bailey, City of Hopewell. Thank you very much for being with us. All other distinguished general officers, active and retired, certainly my Deputy to the Commander, from the party SES. Other members of the Senior Executive Service, John, good to have you here, David, you were. You presented my wife, Michelle, good to have you here, dear. Other distinguished guests, fellow members, fellow soldiers, friends, and family of the Ordnance School of the Team. Thank you all for taking the time to join us this morning to celebrate the accomplishments of the Brigadier General Clark LeMasters. Today is indeed a new beginning for the Ordnance Corps, and the possibilities, I think, are certainly endless. The Corps is postured now for successful execution of their mission on the 21st century battlefield. Because of Clark's leadership, his strategic thinking, and his acumen for warrior training, unquestionably, Clark, you have executed your mission with excellence, and you have also been very capably led the school. Please allow me to touch on your accomplishments. He completed the historical Brack move and relocated the home of ordnance after 92 years of Aberdeen Proving Grounds in Harrisburg. Since that time, he's trained over 35,000 initial military training soldiers for the operating force. He's continued the work of transitioning selected ordnance school forces to what we refer to as skills-based training. Even though the training teams have awarded what we call the Hotel 8 additional skill identifier to over 300 soldiers in the theater, and he's trained numerous more on the specific details of how to recover MRAP, the family view. Of course, he's provided leadership, direction, and guidance for numerous sustaining initiatives ranging from materiel to organizational to doctrinal that solve critical capability gaps in the ordinance. And he's continued to educate Army leaders on the two-level maintenance. General Stevenson would be very happy. Clark, we are extremely lucky to have had you at the helm as the 36th Chief of Ordnance. You embrace your mission and you leave a proud legacy. You have delivered for the Army, you've delivered for the Ordnance School, and for the warfighter every single day. You have ensured that the Ordnance School provided the warfighter with warrior soldiers who are the best trained, and they've been trained to the right standard, and they're ready to perform their mission anywhere on the globe. On a personal level, from day one, since the time that Clark and I have been here together, I've been impressed with your leadership, with your drive, with what I've always seen as extremely clear thought, with his initiatives, with his decision making, and certainly the superior reputations that he brought to me. To say that I admire and respect Clark is a tremendous honor. You are a tremendous general officer with potential to serve our Army at the very highest level, and I, for one, hope to. Clark leaves us to assume command of the 13th Sustained Command Expeditionary at Fort Hood, Texas, and will then immediately deploy to Afghanistan. So congratulations, Clark. I know you will succeed, and in doing so, you'll make us all very, very proud. And of course, this morning, we cannot forget that there's been another person on the journey who has provided support to Clark, and particularly on all the tough days, his wife, Cricket. I think everyone here knows that Cricket actually completed her own 12-month deployment this past year. So having to manage her own very successful career, combined with being a mother and the very visible spouse and supporter of the 36th Chief of Ordnance, that's all been a tremendous undertaking. And yet, I think we all say that you've accomplished all of that with grace and with apparent ease. So CASCOM and the Army cannot thank you for it. So we say a very special thank you for your love and your support that you provide Clark, for just being there when and where he is. So everyone here wishes good luck and the best of fortunes. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving Clark a big round of applause. As always, I want to say thanks to the 4D band. They do a tremendous job. They went to a concert called Wellness last night. They thrilled the community. You sound terrific, as you always do. I also want to say thanks to the soldiers of the Salute Battery. They did a wonderful job heading the profession. So, as we go forward from here today, I would ask that everyone embrace the challenges that lie ahead for all of us. Dedicate ourselves to rising to meet those challenges. Never quit. Never accept defeat. And let's look out for one another. Never leave our comrades or our co-workers or our neighbors behind. Army strong. Go Ordnance.
Ladies and gentlemen, Brigadier General Clark W. LeMasters, Jr.
Well, my remarks will not be quite so elegant, and I'll try to keep it light, because this is really a significant thing to me. I didn't want to get the colors up. It wasn't just an act. And this was a little unexpected on the timeline. First, I am just humbled by the number of people showed up. As General Hodge said, General Wilson came down to participate. Also, former chief of ordnance. The school's changed a lot. But the great thing is it's still got those same kind of soldiers, men and women that want to join our force. And they're still out there. And as always, Mr. Weissman, a great supporter of the school. Thanks. And Mayor, thank you for coming. We found out in one of the functions that we were at that we're kind of homeboys and homegirls. Her family is just 5 or 6 miles, lived 5 or 6 miles from where my mother was. Is right now where I was raised for most of the time I wasn't moving around in the Army. So that was a refreshing thing to come down to the great city of Oakville and find somebody from up in that neck of the woods. And we brought you something back from home that I just haven't got a chance to bring it to you. But with all that aside, thanks so much for everybody. There's too many distinguished guests here to go through a list, and I think both General Hodge and the narrator have covered down them quite well. I first want to thank everybody that put this thing together. I truly, this time, didn't have anything to do with it at all, other than I snuck in yesterday afternoon after getting a haircut and walked through the ceremony, and I do appreciate it. It would not have come together without the great front office staff that I've got. Leadership of Colonel Mason, who is a great leader and a great asset to CASCOM. Barbara, Jeff, my aide, Chris, the XO. As always, the band, you class up the act. It's not too hard when you come on this side of the road to class it up. We appreciate you coming over and doing that. They always make things that much better. Of course, this would not happen without non-commissioned officers. Personal involvement of Regimental Command Sergeant Major, and Brigade Command Sergeant Major, and all the NCOs. They make this stuff happen, and that's why they're the backbone of the Army. I don't want to forget Cindy Finland, who's somewhere probably in the back passed out, who's the protocol person that normally supports us. We've got a great protocol team here at CASCOM, and she normally picks up the load for us. And over this last year, it's been extraordinarily heavy with racks and things. But Cindy, wherever you're at, thanks for everything that you've done while I've been here. You made it so simple, and I really appreciate it. General Hodge, you and Michelle set a tone for us here at Fort Lee. You made it easy to do this job. It's a thrilling thing to have a leader that's willing to allow other leaders to take on initiatives, to keep them informed, to move out. You've never hampered any of the commandants, and I think we'd all agree. And I hope you're satisfied with the teamwork that we've given you. We take it very seriously to be part of the SCOPE team. And I know when I first was getting on board and learned about General Hodge, that's one of the first things I always asked him when we left our update sessions is, do you really feel like we're part of the team? And of course we are. And it's been a great team effort. And I'm going to try to be brief, but it's going to ramble just a little bit, and I'll get through it. First and foremost, I want to thank my wife. As you heard, she hasn't enjoyed all the Fort Lee that I have. But in the short time that she's been back, I know that she's enjoyed her time. She's enjoyed having the neighbors. And being back at Fort Lee, this is our second time here. And now I'm leaving, and she's going to get to move everything to Fort Hood without my help. Include both cars, no matter what Mr. Weissman says. But I did mention to her that that Samuel Sharp Award represents jewelry, so that counts for something. But just as another token of my appreciation, I'd like to present some flowers to my wife. Thanks for all the support, not just here, but throughout the year. I'm not the easiest guy to be married to, and she's earned like 10 of them, Samuel Sharps, the gold clusters and everything. Ceremony, dip kiss, or I'm going to get in trouble. But to continue, Mr. Moore, thank you. Thanks for being the stable guy, the rock that's been here, somebody we can come to and talk to, and the guidance that you give to us. I'm going to miss people in the CASCOM staff, but I've got to mention a few. It's been a great pleasure to work with the staff again. I call him the godfather of Fort Lee, Mr. Santilli. A great guy to be able to go to, very experienced to ask questions. And Penny, his wife, before she moved upstairs to wider priorities and bigger things, was our EA down there and brought me on board. Appreciate that team. What a classy act they are. The Yahtzee Dames. So thanks to the GA staff, Don Hall, and his team. Great support. I have never once felt that it was unfair. We didn't agree on everything. We disagreed on a lot of things. But it was always very fair. We rolled up our sleeves. We got after it. It was all about the priority of work. Walt Dane and the whole G1 team, thanks. I see Mike back here and a bunch of other guys. Whenever we had an issue, we made sure we brought it up to you, but that had to do with personnel. Normally, you told us we need to trim it down, but thanks. It meant a lot to have your expertise to be able to talk to about these problems. And the staff is led by the chief of staff, Colonel Harbor. Appreciate your guidance to the staff. I wouldn't have wanted your job. I wouldn't want this bunch of colonel that you got to try to deal with. I was fortunate I could just walk away and ignore him and only had to worry about the boss. But there's a great bunch of colonels here, a great bunch of expertise. Colonel McGinnis and his team and C-Did, Colonel Cook, Jeff Martin, a great ordnance man in his own right, inducted last year into the Hall of Fame. Great person to come to on just about any issue. Jeff, I really appreciate your mentorship and the advice that you've given me. It's been very beneficial. Within that team with FD, Juanita Gunn and her team, and FIMSA, Mr. Lee Brush, another quiet professional that's over there working the hard fight. Another Ordnance Corps Hall of Fame inductee for this year that was just there helping us get through documentation and many other things. Colonel McPeak's staff down at MSD, Lisa, her team, Brewster, all you guys, Joe, ran through, grab here somewhere, all of them. Just a great opportunity to work with the things, the pieces of equipment and material we put in soldiers' hands and the focus. A lot of other folks inside of CDID that we worked with throughout, we worked with ammunition and different issues. Tom Keegan, a friend of mine since the basic course, probably the best selection that could ever been made for the G3 at CASCOM, understands his business better than most of us. He brought common sense to chaos and really helped a lot for the commandants to be able to work with the staff like his and his whole team. Because under Tom is the doctrine, folks, that I'm a doctrine and work doctrine for all the commandants. I appreciate that. The PME, Professional Military Education Bunch, that works with Mr. Hall and the commandants, trying to balance that out, an act to provide leader training. And of course, the TD team that works with us, John Clancy, John Delius, Yvette Bonner, and that team. What a great group of individuals. That personal contact that we have on a monthly basis, keeping me up to date on everything that was going on ordnance and hopefully the processes that were put in place. I appreciate what you guys have done. It was a great help and really appreciate it. And there'll always be SCOVO to me, but the technology integration bunch, Matt and his crew, a lot of work with us on EOD apps and other things related to the Army Learning Model 2015. Couldn't do it without them, and I think other people come here to see how it's done and done right because they've really got it. You've got to keep this kind of capability inside of the government. Mr. Hall, ALU, great. We could have picked a better guy to come down and lead the effort. Thanks. Your experience as a logistician and your understanding of the business processes, your team, absolutely incredible. Mark McCormick and the work that he's done with us, I can't thank him enough. And to your Bolick and Click 3 staffs that I work with as closely as I can. I don't spend enough time over there. I really appreciate it. And all the leaders within the colleges and staff that help prepare ordnance leaders, they're focused on what we need to do right, and that's make the training as real as possible. To our garrison, the tone of the post is reflected by the people that lead the garrison, and Colonel Edge and Melissa, they don't say no. They may not say yes as heartily as they'd like to on things, but they listen to us, they work with us, and their intent is to make this the best place in the world. It's growing big, and your hands are full now, and they're going to get even more full. Thanks for all your support and all the agencies that pulled together to make this BRAC so very, very successful. The 59th Brigade, I truly believe, toughest Tradoc brigade to command, located here in a cross CONUS, battalion down at Eglin, a battalion down at Gordon, and detachments in two other locations, as well as an incredibly large training mission that goes on here. In the capable hands of Colonel Berry and Command Sergeant Major Crawford, their commanders, their Command Sergeant Major staff, thanks for all your support. And our distant cousins down at Benning and Leonardwood, we have established great relationships with to keep the focus on training and ordnance soldiers wherever they're at. Doesn't matter who owns them, as long as that continues to go on. And then a relationship that we've grown back to reestablishing, and that's the one with the 187th Ordnance Battalion, down at Jackson, who trained wheel vehicle mechanics, and it started the initial steps, hopefully in 2 years, to move that training mission up here and consolidate it the way it should be. To the director of training and the professionals in the departments and divisions down here in the school, thanks for what you do. We could not execute the day-to-day mission without your professionalism. So all of our department and division heads sitting there, to the sergeant majors who are an added combat multiplier to those formations, thanks for what you do. Thanks for keeping the soldiers moving in the right direction. And all the efforts that you've done to embrace skills-based training, the Army Learning Model 2015, and really make it happen. And I know from what the accreditation team is going to tell us that you're going to set the standard in so many areas. I couldn't be prouder. To the DOT Sergeant Major, Sergeant Major Stone, where are you at? I did walk down the ball conference room to see if it was working. It's still moving kind of slow. I'll get somebody to run down here and take a picture of it every once in a while. Make sure that it gets done by ordinance week. We've had great sergeant majors in DOT. We've got great civilians inside of the training management office that just keep the engines of this ship moving in the right direction. I can't thank you all enough for what you do. And then the partnership that you form with the QA and lessons learned folks here on post. Mark said, we've suffered through the accreditation and prepping for that, but it was driven by that close relationship and the drive for excellence that the QA has done. Couldn't have done it without you. As we move across the road now to the staff up in the main building, to the personnel development office, which is really the key and only infantryman that I have to put into the fight directly in my hand, to current Lieutenant Colonel Promotable Lawrence Schreiner and Sergeant Major Bowles, thanks. Thanks for keeping us on track. They look out for the health of the people in the ordnance corps. And I'll tell you, they've made great strides. We've done some things that are remarkable, and I think it will shape the corps for the future. And there's a few more things on the to-do list that I wish I could stay around to help you with, but I know you'll get after them. Our reserve component office, our tie to the reserve component, which is absolutely critical. Lieutenant Colonel Marvin Klein has stepped up and has been the acting RCO for us for so long, and Sergeant Major Boss. That team of professionals maintains that link with the U.S. Army Reserve and the National Guard that is so critical to the mission that we perform, because we have a fairly large mission training in the reserve component. Unique to the Ordnance Corps is the Explosive Ordnance Directorate. Colonel Pat Kelly and his team couldn't have picked a better guy to come in, former EOD Group Commander, to stand this thing up and make it work. It's what it's all about. It is providing efficiencies that just didn't exist before. It's bringing together things that are needed. It's looking at the capabilities for EOD soldiers, and it's a focal point. And I believe they could have picked a better group of people to come in there, you and your team, that make great strides for EOD, and thanks for your hard work. To our front office, to our XOs that have been through, I saw Riley Parker get back from Afghanistan, to both Tim Bird and Jeff Quail, the birds, that's what we call them, the bird man. I keep picking guys with names of birds. So if you come out the hood, I got a guy named Eagle. to Barb, Nadine, to Penny, the folks that have been down there helping me along the way, to Beth and Staff Sergeant Whittington, appreciate the support that you've given me. You've made the job easy. We've got a great association with the Ordnance Corps Association. They've done super things. Supporting scholarship programs, supporting our soldiers, supporting us with the Sanders Sharp Award and other things. Recently stood up a foundation to form, raise money to build a memorial over on the Ordnance campus that we're working. To that whole team and what I call the Ordnance Corps Auxiliary, all of our retired officers, NCOs, and soldiers that are out there, and how they come together to help us, to include our current leadership, General Retired Solomon, General Retired Colburn, CW5 Retired Worm, and Command Sergeant Major Steve McWilliams. Their support and their advice have been tremendous to me as a branch chief, and I really appreciate it. And the continued support of that organization, all you got to do is ask, and you'll have them come in. To my regimental team, Command Sergeant Major Muhammad, a true NCO, and Chief Satterfield, who couldn't be here today, he's in Europe representing us for the long ball. Couldn't ask for two better battle buddies than Wigman. We've had some great trips, had some great conversations in the evening, and I'm very proud of what these two guys have done for their part of the Ordnance Corps, from the NCO and the warrant officer perspective. They've really shaped it. As with any military organization, as soon as you arrive, the sands and the hourglass start running, and it's time to go before you know it. And this was a little unexpected, and if I could do any way about the reason the transition happened, I'd change it, but I can't. So we're moving. We're going on. As I look back at the many accomplishments, many of them the CG covered very aptly, the things that I would reemphasize is our engagement with the field. We got to stay in touch with what's going on in the field army, and you got to stay in touch with it at the lowest level. Don't go out there talking to the colonels and the generals. Get down there to the captains, lieutenants, and warrant officers and NCOs. They're the ones that make it happen for us on the battlefield. They're the ones where the problems exist, and the things that we can do to fix and make their job simpler is what really is a combat multiplier on the field. Stay engaged. You need to communicate across the staff and keep that going. We've got an incredible amount of people talking across ordnance land now, and it's very important. Bring in those warrant officers, NCOs, and officers that are going through ALU training and run our concepts by them to make sure that they work. Continue to work on the ordnance campaign plan, which is really all about getting people talking. Doesn't matter how you package it or what you call it, but everybody that has something to do with ordnance work needs to get together and share. You need to make sure that those sector stakes are interlinked and you got the fires that you need and you're properly prioritized. Town halls, the ordnance worldwide, BTC, the brown bags, all those things that we've been doing is all about communication and getting the story out there. I ask you to keep those things going and make sure you share the information across the sustainment community. Defend your programs, make sure you got the facts to back them up, and the details in that work that you can stand up in front of anybody and defend it. And where possible, get the supportive commander to be an advocate. You'll find those infantry and armor officers, engineers to help support you. Because they're the guys that carry a little bit more weight sometimes than we do in the fight in the Pentagon, and that's what it's all about. Utilize the experts that we have in the school, and I know it's tough. I know it's tough to reach down into departments and divisions where we're short on instructors and there's a heavy force load, but unfortunately that's where the subject matter expertise exists sometimes. Figure out how to balance that. And help the CASCOM staff utilize that as they go forward developing .NOPF capabilities and provide those experts to them as we can. It's very important. To the instructors and platoon sergeants that are out there, we can't tell you enough how important the job is you do, and we don't. You're in the trenches every day making that mission happen. We could not do it without you. Keep that communication going outside of Fort Lee. Tell the Army what the Ordnance Corps is about. Keep the letters coming, the BTCs, the newsletters going. That's what is important. And when they come back to you and tell you you're all made up, listen to what they got to say, because they might be right. Things look different from Fort Lee than they do when you get in Afghanistan. So I ask you to take a look at that. Make sure you're still current. Check your information. And they're more than willing to help you out and empower them to help solve problems. We've established some great relationships with the field. Keep them up. The rock drills and things like that, hugely powerful. You continue to raise the bar in everything you do. The BRAC provided you a platform for excellence that nowhere across the Army can you find anything better than that. You've got the quality people. I've seen the energy that you've got. Take what you learned from this accreditation and what you're going to learn from the DCGI and TPOI review and move us forward. Keep us moving towards ALM 2015 and skills-based training, because it's the right way to do it. You got a great guy that's sitting up in the front now with Dr. Armstrong moving up as a deputy. Rick, you'll keep them online, I know you will, and I really appreciated working with you. I know you're going to balance that hat, you and Steve and the team down here, about the training mission, and I have no concerns at all that it's going to be executed flawlessly across the board. I ask you to look at a way that we can figure out how to train our leaders where we mix Poland, Click 3, ALC, SLC, one officer basic and advanced, integrate them into decision-making and learning environments where they come together to replicate what we do in the field, and that solves problems. And most of the time, the problems aren't sustainment problems. Start training them how to communicate now, and I'm telling you, it's going to pay off for the Army. They'll be able to solve any issue, and they'll keep us going on the right path. I'll close and tell you one last thing, and that is we got to figure out this relationship with the reserve component. As we move forward into an area with constrained resources, we have to make the One Army school system work. And it's going to be painful, but we've got to figure out how to bring the reserve component and the active component together so that we're training one mission from one fight. There's not resources, there's not opportunities to allow this to exist, and we truly need one ordnance school system that works across the board. I'd love to stay and fight through this list of stuff. I didn't see many of you taking notes, so I can come back, Jim. But I can't. I got to go. It's time to move on to something else. I will tell you that you got a supporter wherever I go, and I'll miss y'all, and thanks. Go Ordnance.
Thank you for attending, and we look forward to seeing all of you at Ordnance Week in May to celebrate the 200th anniversary of the Ordnance Corps.